Okay, originally this talk was going to be called Lifecycle of Oil. Really got into it, and it's a long history there, so we're just going to look at a component of that. So we're going to do Lifecycle of Oil, Geology Rocks. A couple geologists get that joke. Nice work. All right, so, you know, here's my outline, but basically what we're going to do is we're going to introduce what oil is. We're going to make some simplifications around the concept of oil, but really what I want to instill with you is that creating oil is sort of a recipe process where there are certain components, processes, and outcomes that create the end product, what is oil. Big picture, why I'm even talking about oil. So in the Office of Fossil Energy, we're working on a crude oil characterization study, and what we're trying to do there is compare conventional and unconventional oils. And these are terms I'm going to address in a little bit, but you've probably heard them now with the shale revolution increases in domestic production. It's a game changer in the United States, so we're going to touch on that. But really, again, the interest here is describing geologic controls on unconventional oil. So let's get into it. So first, information. I'm a former EIA, Energy Information Analyst, Administration Analyst, geologist there. I see some people in the audience. Thanks for coming out. So I'm going to use a lot of their work. They provide excellent infographics, data, maps, and I'm going to use them throughout this presentation. So really just important points here. Oil is a mixture of hydrocarbons. It's a soup of all sorts of entrained gases, inert, volatile gases, water, muck. It's a soup. And because it exists on a wide spectrum of properties, it presents challenges when you deal with it. And one of those challenges has been with the increase in unconventional oil production, there's been an increase in shipping crude by rail. You may have heard out in just the general environment that there have been some incidents of derailment, some real tragic losses. So this is a real issue that we're trying to work on here at DOE. So we got to introduce oil. So really, here's a picture of hydrocarbons. Again, hydrocarbons exist on a sort of this spectrum where different properties at both ends. So if we look at these, we're increasing in sort of heavy density materials to lighter, essentially more pure materials. So if we call these heterogeneous mixtures, there's a lot of stuff in there. And we may call these homogeneous mixtures, sort of single component. And again, if we think about this in the context of transporting crude oil, it's how do these properties influence that transport? So that's something really to consider as we move forward. So we're going to do this sort of in a geologic context, but also in a state profile setting. This is, again, information from EIA. I've modified it slightly. I don't know if it's still in the EIA color palette, so we'll have to review that. That's an inside EIA joke. Okay, so what we have here, essentially is production volumes on the left axis, on the x-axis, the y-axis. On the x-axis is API gravity. So if we go back, when we say low API gravity, we mean dense or heavy stuff. And when we say high API gravity, we mean lighter stuff. So if we look at this California profile, they produce primarily heavy oils. If we look at Texas, huge state, lots of producing areas, they have a more normal distribution of a demographic where they produce a variety of heavy, middle, and light oils. And then there's North Dakota, an area of unconventional oil production, which predominantly produces this light oil. So again, you know, for simplification, sort of heavier oil profiles, lighter oil profiles, more unconventional oils, more conventional oils. So let's begin really where every oil and gas talk should begin, at the sun. So really what's going on here is, you know, our solar system formed many, many billions of years ago. The sun is undertaking hydrogen fusion, converting hydrogen into helium, and in doing so, emitting electromagnetic radiation energy. And 93 million miles later, we arrive at this little gem, Earth. And Michael, in his previous talk, did a great job sort of outlining some geology here. So really just to take away a few points, density matters everywhere, but on Earth especially. So we have heavier materials that kind of sink into the core. We have lighter materials on top. And because everything is sort of density driven, these lighter materials can surf on top of these heavier materials. And that's really important in the geologic rock cycle, where you'll have mountain building events, erosion occurring, sediments running downhill, everything's gravity driven, density driven. But most critically, Earth provides the base components to produce oil. And specifically, we'll look at the atmosphere, CO2, carbon dioxide as a source. But what's most important and critical about Earth with respect to oil is life. We're fortunate to exist, be here today. But really what's going on here is these organisms are capturing solar energy and converting it into organic material. Organic material, so, you know, we've got jellyfish, we've got diatoms, we've got krill, we've got algae, we have all these little critters floating all around the oceans and rivers and lakes. And again, they're capturing that light energy and turning it into organic material. So these organisms over time are going to do this. So this is a picture from space. That's the tip of Brittany in France, and that's Wales. And what we have here is a massive algal bloom. So when you think about sort of the scale, what we have going on is basically photosynthesis and carbon sequestration at a massive scale, where, again, light energy is coming down, hitting these organisms, they're taking in CO2, they're creating organic material, and then they're dying, and they're sinking to the bottom of the ocean. So over time, huge volumes of this organic material builds up. So this is sort of the recipe I wanted to introduce, where we have this solar energy combined with this organic materials, combined with time, heat, and pressure, and we get this precursor material to hydrocarbons called kerogen. It's black rock, oily to the touch, really just hydrocarbon-rich compressed material. And with more time, heat, and pressure, this rock is going to be converted into these liquids or gases. And essentially, it's called catagenesis, but it's the process of converting this kerogen into hydrocarbons that we use today. So oil is like a cake in that sense, where we've got these ingredients, we've got a process to combine them together, and then we have to cook them just right. And so this is where I need to stop and spend a few seconds here talking about a lot going on. So we've introduced the terms conventional and unconventional. Conventional oils, Michael introduced the term sweet spot. Conventional oils were sort of a sweet spot play where there were fewer areas where oil and gas had over time migrated. With respect to oil and gas, you need a couple things here, so I'll just point them out. You need a seal. You need an impermeable layer to trap everything down. You need a source, that organic material that we talked about. You need migration paths, usually between those, so this, as Michael described, stuff wants to rise sometimes out of the earth, so oil and gas will migrate upward. So when we talk about unconventional today, we've been traditionally targeting these sweet spots, these reservoirs where oil and gas had migrated to. What's distinct about unconventional oil is now we're targeting the source rock. We're creating flow paths that previously didn't exist. So why that really is a game changer is we've gone from limited areas of production to essentially massive areas of production. So connecting this diagram to this and sort of reintroducing this cake concept, when you bake a cake just right, you've got that perfect fluffiness, that perfect moisture content, and if you imagine sort of preparing that cake batter, doing all that work, and then putting it in the oven, if we introduce, again, time, pressure, and heat, over time, stuff sinks, so older stuff is below younger stuff. As you sink, pressure increases. With that pressure, temperature increases. Also, this concept that we'll just touch on is thermal maturity. It's basically how well you bake that cake. So with respect to oil, there's a window as a function of time, pressure, and heat where you'll find oil. If it's too cold, you won't create that oil. If it's too hot, you're going to cook off that oil, and you'll be primarily left with gas. And then to such an extent, you'll essentially cook off that gas, and that's what's called overmature source rock. So unconventional oil exists potentially in a lot of places. It may be deeper, it may be more challenging to reach, but the greater volumes incentivize us to look for that. So back at my time at EIA, I worked with a great group of colleagues on updating the shale plays of the lower 48 states. And again, what I want to speak to here is the prevalence of these shale resources, these type formations, were really well endowed in the United States. And each play has its own unique age. So if we go back in the Cambrian to the Miocene, we're going from older periods in time to newer periods in time. So as I said, stuff is sort of layered. The old stuff's at the bottom and the younger stuff is at the top. And that geologic history drives what type of oil you may have. So to do this, we're going to take a little trip. So please keep your arms and legs in the vehicle. And we're going to go back in time. So just to set this up, what I'm going to show you are past environments. Right now, we are 550 million years in the past, a long time ago. And what we have here, this is work out of Northern Arizona University. But what they've done is they've recreated past environments with respect to modern countries. So in this example, we have Canada and the United States as it would have existed 550 million years ago. And this blue stuff is oceans, the darker stuff is deeper oceans, lighter oceans, and then these are continents. If you recall, I said continents are sort of made out of this lighter material, so this stuff can kind of surf on the Earth's surface. And what we're going to do is we're going to go from 550 million years ago to the present and watch sort of how the domestic United States, the lower 48, changes over that time. And I'm going to stop off a few places to point out some stuff. So, well, again, what you're going to see are oceans changing, land masses sort of moving, doing a dance. So we'll just start going. And we're going to move through time, so you can watch that. So we're in the late Precambrian, a long time ago. Sea level is changing. Again, you can sort of see modern states underlined. So right now, the United States is covered in a shallow sea. You'll see sort of these components in Alabama and Mississippi. If you were to match that up with this map, there are geologic geologic structures that match this setting. So we'll keep going. We'll keep going. Ordovician, long time ago. Fish are starting to show up. First sort of algal things are starting to grow on the Earth. Silurian, first bony fish. Very exciting times for everyone. Okay, case study one. Because I got some bony fish fans. Nice. That was a big deal just before we didn't have bony fish and now we do. So here we are in the North Dakota, as I said, unconventional oil, and we're now in the Devonian period. So 400 million years ago, long time ago, but what we're going to see here is a really prolific inland sea migrate across North Dakota. You may have heard the Bakken Formation. So when we produce oil and gas from this area, it's a result of this shallow sea activity. So we'll just go through the Devonian really quickly. And as you can see, that inland sea is migrating across North Dakota. So sediments are running off. Those organisms that I talked about earlier are dying, and they're getting stacked and covered with sediments. So it's building up over time. So we'll just keep going. So we were in an old period, and we're, again, moving forward through the Pennsylvania. Beautiful coal is developing in Pennsylvania and Ohio. So now we're at Texas. So Texas has a wide profile of oil and gas, and that's because Texas is massive and it has a unique geologic history. So if we look at this section of the map, we're talking about the Permian section now, so 290 million years ago. And as you can see in West Texas, a beautiful inland sea about the size of Syria is forming, and we've got these matching Permian plays to produce oil from. We also have older stuff that we should have mentioned in the past, but Cambrian stuff, so we'll just keep going. Basically, seas are migrating across Texas for the long haul. So much oil, so much gas, or precursors to oil and gas. Long history, still in the Cretaceous. So this is when dinosaurs are about to go extinct, unfortunately. But we'll keep going. And we're getting into an environment that's sort of, you know, is more similar to what we have today, only 40 million years ago. Florida has yet to form, but now we're in the Oligocene. Okay, so last stop. So I said in the past that North Dakota has light unconventional oil. Texas sort of has all types of oil. Here in California, we have mostly heavy oil. And if we remember that it's a function of time, heat, and pressure, if we look at the California resources that we would develop oil and gas from, they're just forming only pretty recently, 15 million years ago. So we're just essentially putting them in that oven to bake. So they really don't have enough time to fully cook to become sort of lighter and fluffier than other oils. So we'll just fast forward through time. And interesting, you can watch the Baja of California migrate up. They say California's going to fall off eventually. That's totally true. You can see it migrating up. So, you know, last ice age, sea levels were lower because we had all this water trapped up. But here we are today. So what I wanted to just touch is because of that trip we just went through, we have a lot of oil and gas. We had a lot of organic material being deposited in a variety of environments over a long history across a large area. So because of that, the shale revolution has been really successful in this country just simply because the resource is there, the geology is there, the time and the heat, the pressure are all there. The recipe really works in the United States. So again, if we think about, you know, the timing of stuff, how it matters and where it's located as the function of time, heat, and pressure, we get these hydrocarbons with different properties. And that's important. Again, you know, in the concept of crude by rail, how do we transport a gas versus something that's almost a solid? You don't transport them the same. So, you know, again, when it comes to oil, you want to be in that perfect window. You want to make that cake that is just right. And here in the United States, we're really fortunate to have a lot of areas that exist in this oil window. And then we have a lot of areas that exist in the gas window. So again, these geologic controls are really what drives our resource abundance here. And because, again, there's a long history there, we'll just deal with these properties of crude oil in different manners. But here at DOE, we're working with our partners at DOT PHMSA, Transport Canada, our neighbors to the north, to try to get a handle on these properties and how these properties influence hazards with respect to transport. So, you know, we've been through a lot, so I think we'll just identify that we're in this area of resurgence. These new oils are sort of distinct from the past oils. And in terms of oil demographics, we're moving from this more conventional side of the spectrum to a more unconventional spectrum. And again, just how do we deal with that is the question at hand. So I hope this is a picture of a cake, and it is. So thank you very much.